let's talk about clean code, which is something that coders are passionate about. What is clean code? Clean code is essentially code that is easy and pleasant to read, that is easy to maintain, and that is flexible enough that you can reuse some of the coding elements. And bad code has a smell, as coders say. You can see that it's bad code because it's hard to read, it's hard to understand. So I'm gonna show you bad code now, and hopefully I can convince you that this is bad code. So here's a code that does something, but I challenge you to tell me what the code does. Take a little bit of time to look at it. Actually, that's a fairly simple code, but because it's so impenetrable, it's very hard to understand what it does. So let's try to improve this code by refactoring it. And refactoring means rewriting it. So here I'm gonna start by renaming the variable. So the first variable is actually a geothermal gradient. So I call it geothermal gradient. The second variable is a temperature. So I call it temp. And it's in Fahrenheit, so I keep the F. And finally, the third here is depth in meters. So you see that by giving the variables a name that is meaningful, all of a sudden the code becomes much more understandable. And if I replace all the variable names in that code, I obtain something like this. Now that's more verbose, it's longer, but hopefully you will agree that it's also easier to understand. But that code is still not perfect. That code still has some problems because the logic of what the application is doing, what the code is doing, is not really separated from the variable that are in the code. And then there's a lot of repetition. So let's look at this. So what I mean by this is that we clearly have variables here. And then here we have some application logic, some math that is being done. And what's not great is that the same math seems to be done three times. That depth in meters, which clearly is a conversion from temperature in the well to a depth using the geothermal gradient and also doing a transformation from Fahrenheit to Celsius, well, that logic is repeated three times, here, here, and there. And the problem is that this is prone to bugs and it clutter your code. And indeed, there is a bug. Have you spotted it? The conversion of the last temperature is incorrect. It should not be 4/9, it should be 5/9. So we can actually improve on this tremendously by using functions. Functions are here to capture the logic of the application. They're here for you to put the logic of what the application is doing and test that logic. Testing is so important. So a function should have a clear name and also do one thing, not 10 things. So that if you do 10 things, you have 10 functions. And that way you can reuse those functions much more easily and they're also more easy to understand. So let's start with a function that will convert my temperature from Fahrenheit to Celsius. So here it is. This is a function that can convert my temperature from Fahrenheit to Celsius, and I can test this function by calling it and giving it a temperature of 32 Fahrenheit, and as expected, I get 0°C, which is the correct answer. So you see, because I can test my function, if there is a problem with my conversion, I'll see it immediately. And because I will reuse the same function for all the conversion, even if I have a million data points, if I have the logic correctly in the function, everything will be correctly. So tracking bugs becomes much easier if your code is logically organized. But the conversion from Fahrenheit to Celsius is not the only function we can write. We can also write a function that converts a temperature in degrees Celsius into depth using the geothermal gradient. So let's do this. So here's my function. You can see that I enter the temperature, the geothermal gradient, then it's a very simple function, and I can test it by giving it some parameters I can control. So in this case, I gave 30°C and the geothermal gradient was 30°/km, and then I get an output of 1 km. So again, the fact that I can test my function ensures that my logic is sound. And of course, you don't usually test on one value, you test on a range of values and boundary conditions. But the clean code doesn't stop at writing function. Remember, we had a mix of variable and logic together in the application. So let's try to improve on this. So what I'll do now is I'll take that old code and I will basically move around the different variables. So here I'm looking at the geothermal gradients, grouping them together because then it's easier to see that I have three geothermal gradients. And I'll do the same for the temperatures, group them together. And the third temperature. And then I'm left with a bunch of code here in the middle that really has a sole function to do something with the variable. That's the application logic right there. So what I'll do now is I will create data tuples. I'll put my temperature and my geothermal gradient together because you will see that it's more convenient later. But of course, first I need to convert my temperature from Fahrenheit to Celsius. So there you go, at position zero in a tuple, I basically do a conversion of the Fahrenheit temperature into Celsius, and then I put the geothermal gradient. So now that tuple of data, or what I call data one, has the temperature in Celsius for data number one, and the geothermal gradient. And of course, I can do this now for data two and three, which represents the other variables. And I want now to create a list that contains all of the tuples of data because it will make my other code much cleaner. So I'll call this all data and I create a list. So remember, you just use the square brackets and that's data one, comma, data two, comma, data three. And now I have a list of all of my data that I can use further in my application. So now that I've cleaned my code, I have a nice list of tuple of data. It's very easy to manipulate and I can rewrite the application logic and you will see it will become much easier to understand. So what I'll do is I'll just get rid of this and I will very simply write for data in all data, which remember all data is actually my list of tuple. And so that means that this data here that is referred in the for loop refers to respectively data one, data two, and data three. So now what am I going to do with this? Well, I want to print it. Remember the application prints this to the screen. And what I want to print is really using my other function temp to depth, because what I want to print is the depth, but what I need to give it is first a temperature, and that temperature I will find at position zero in my tuple. You see it here. So all I have to write is data and zero, and that refers to data zero, and then data one will be the geothermal gradient. So that function will now calculate a depth for all the data in my old data list. And when I execute it, I get the depth in meters. So hopefully you can see that this is a very logical way to work around your code. Now, it may not be natural at first, and it takes practice to be able to refactor and rewrite your code like this. But the more you practice, the better you will become at it, and the easier it will become for you and your peers to read your code. So let's look at the final code. So this is the final program. You can see it's longer than the original, but hopefully you will agree that it is much more readable because we have two functions that are clearly defined at the top, and it's very clear without even putting any comments what they do. It's clear what they do because they're simple function and also because their name is meaningful and the logic is very easy to follow. Then in the middle, I have my variables that are declared, and then below I have my tuple that is defined, and finally the application logic is a very simple for loop. Now, clean code, you know, it's an art as well as it is a science. There are other possibilities to write that code, and I could probably refactor that code again and again and again, making it always more understandable and logical. So it's also a little bit your style. So there's not just one solution to clean code, but not clean code or dirty code is very easy to spot. You know, if the person who reads your code cannot understand it, you're in trouble. So always strive to make your code logically organized, give it meaningful variable name, and ensure that it is readable. And it doesn't really hurt to ask someone else to read your code. It's called a code review and give you feedback on how your code is.